been raining non-stop for about 327 days, but I can't wait any longer. I've got a new tent to have a look at. Let me go and grab it, get it pitched up in the garden, and then we'll let you have a look. With the tent, you get 12 of these pinky red aluminium pegs. They do feel really strong. They've got like a square profile to them and a little hook on the end. We've got guy line, pole repair sleeve, and some repair fabric or a repair swatch. For the poles, you've got one that's the main arch of the tent and then four smaller poles that go into each corner. Here's my first pitch of the Robins Chaser 2. Used all 12 pegs. You can see you've got a guy line on each corner and then one on each side of the main arch as well. Not gonna lie, it did take me about 15 minutes to set it up just because I was messing around with all the guy lines and getting everything connected together. It's not perfect by any means, but let's jump in and have a look inside. On the door we've got a couple of bits of Velcro and then this vent at the top, and then the door's dual zipped so you can leave it open a little bit at the top to get some airflow, or you can shut it off. This tent as well, there's a diagram here that shows you, you can pitch it in multiple ways, so you can have the inner and outer pitch together like what I've done here, or you can do the outer fly sheet only, you can have the inner only, or you can do a half and half if you want to do some stargazing. So we'll have a look at how that works later. When you open the door, you've got two toggles to hold it open here, and then we've got dual zips on the inner door, and it goes all the way around, so there's only this bit here where the door's connected. One thing I will say straight away, and you would kind of expect it I guess, is the materials feel very thin. So the floor and the outer, I believe, are both 20D nylon. Oop, here comes trouble. Now 20D nylon's fine for the fly, but the bathtub and the base here does feel really, really thin. Floor does have a 5,000 millimeter hydrostatic head though, so you shouldn't have any problems with water getting in. And the outer's a 2,000 millimeter hydrostatic head, so you'd need some really serious torrential rain to get through that. So inside there is a pocket to shove that door into to keep it out of the way. It's all this black mesh material. We've got another pocket on the opposite side here with a load of labels on it. You can probably see in the corner there, there's an eyelet that's what you use if you want to pitch the inner only. So that eyelet goes into the small pole that's in the corner. You unclip the connector there and clip that to the guy line on the outside. There's a thing here that says low vent on it with a toggle. So we'll go outside and have a look how that works soon. You haven't got a massive vestibule area in this tent. You'd probably have enough space to store your boots and a couple of cooking bits, maybe your pack if you stood it up. There's no vestibule on the other side, you've just got this kind of triangle piece for a bit of extra storage. Definitely not a two-man tent this. It's called a Chaser 2, it's wide enough for two mats technically, but when you bring gear into the equation, you're just not going to have enough space for two people. You've got this washing line thing as well that goes up from that corner up to here to the roof line and then comes across and is on this line lock here, so you can dry your bits and bobs if you want to, or you can just unhook it from there and get rid of it. Head height's fine in the middle. I'm 5'11". I'm obviously not sat on a mat or anything at the minute, but I've got a bit of head height there. And then if I lay down, there should be plenty of length in this because it's made for Germans. So at that, my feet are touching the bottom and I can only just reach the end of the tent there with my arm. So actually thinking about it, if you did want to put your pack inside, you could probably put it down the foot end and just bump your head further up the top, or put your pack at your head end. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not saying the tent's not strong, I'm just saying it feels really thin. I'm used to having sort of 60D bathtubs in my tents, and that's why this feels thin. It doesn't mean it's weak or it's going to rip, but it's just something that I'd be cautious of personally. It does mean that you get a really light tent as well. This weighs, with all the pegs, poles, all the tags that you could take off, all the bags, 1.4 kilos or just under 1.5 kilos. That's the benefit that you're getting when you switch to materials like this. Well, let's get out and have a look at these vents, shall we? So that makes sense now. It says low vent on the end, look, and that will mean that we can peg that together so that it raises that bottom and then it lets some airflow in through this mesh on the inner. Let's see how this stargazer mode works. I think there was a problem with how the guy lines were connected on this from the factory, because what you need to do to roll back this outer is unclip this buckle from that top corner so you can roll that back up, and then you basically put the short pole in here, clip it onto there, and then run the guy line from there. But this guy line with the buckle on it is actually tied onto the outer. So what I've done on the other corner already is swap this tie out point and put it on the inner, so that that will now buckle into there, and then I'll be able to pull that out properly just with the inner. And there it is, that's the kind of half and half configuration. So you've still got some shelter, but you can lay and look at the stars if you want to. Like I say, I had to change these guy lines over. It would have been better to have a clip at the top and the bottom, I think, because if I wanted to pitch this outer only now, I've still got to untie this and tie it back onto the connector on the outer. You can pitch it just with the inner as well. What you have to do then is unhook these hoops and you thread the pole through those hoops rather than through the sleeve on the fly sheet. So it's a tough one, this. This is obviously just a first look, and it's different to any tent that I've tried before. Pitching it was a little bit of a faff, but I'm convinced that's just because it was the first time I've pitched it, and it feels like it's going to be a totally different experience to camping in sort of freestanding tents or the big trekking pole tents like the Lanshan 2 that I'm used to. Price wise, it's not the cheapest tent, it's not a budget tent, but if it does deliver on everything that it promises, I think it could potentially be quite good value for money. So I paid just over £200 for this tent from Alpine Trek, but I believe it was the last one that they had in stock. I've had a Google around and you can pick them up for about £260, and I'm told that Outdoor Gear Essentials are getting them in stock soon as well. So if you do want to have a look at one of these, have a bit of a Google or keep your eye on Outdoor Gear Essentials and look out for Col getting them in. I forgot to mention as well, this tent has been tested in some pretty high wind speeds, 190 kilometers an hour, I think it says on the leaflet and the documentation, which is just above 50 mile an hour winds as an average for the test. So it should put up to some pretty decent conditions, or rough conditions. I just need to get out in it now, practice pitching it a few more times, take it out for a proper camp before I can give you a final verdict on it. But let me know what you think to it down in the comments. We'll be taking it out for a proper test soon, so subscribe and I'll see you in the next one.